say before I read this, some of this, writing some of this was, even though I was in the 1950s and 60s as a child, a lot of things hadn't changed. And like the fair days were still going strong. And there's other things in the book that it was, you know, because I actually lived them the same as they would have in the late 1800s. So I suppose this reflects my own excitement going on a fair day. Excuse my peacock. In the weeks before the fair, Tyke told Manus about the fair days when he was a boy. Back then, before the Gurtha Mór, it was a family day out. It was a day when men wore their shoes because they were ashamed if people saw them barefoot in town. The women and children went barefoot. Since the silence after the hunger, the fairs changed. Only the men went, and only their stock to sell. The fail of music, street singing and dancing stopped. The composers of ballads found nobody to buy their strong sheets. But only the fiery fighting men missed the faction fights that happened the late evening when they drank too much. Strong farmers from rich pastures up the country bore tidings of improvements. The drover was busy driving bony cattle from the west, where the green pastures of the Midlands put flesh on their ribs. Then the day came, and he was crossing the bridge. Just as Dad had said, he heard the fair before he saw it. The lowing of cattle, bleating of sheep, or squeal of bonnets hit his ears all at once. The lone sentinel, Tom Rooster, grew hoarse, making himself heard. Animal sounds blended together as the peasants and jobbers raised their voices to get heard above the din. Cowherds cursed shepherds and the farmers cursed everything as each man struggled to keep his few animals together. And now started his hee-haw, hee-haw as the fertile scent of another arsehole reached his nostrils. Lord on Enoch, he heard people say, meaning in the middle of the fair, when they wanted to describe being in the centre of an action of any sort. Crossing the bridge, Manus understood why they said it. His wide eyes darted, trying to take in the huge new world that opened up across the river. The familiar scent of animals and their droppings rose like a freshly turned dunghill. But winter noticed in the excitement of the moment. They corralled the family stock and prevented them from mixing with other men's animals. Manus admired the array of colours and types of cattle on offer. When the stock had settled, Dad had pointed out the different breeds to his son. There's a Dexter, he would say, or a Hereford, or a Kerry Meeking cow. He showed Manus the small black Angus that had recently swapped the Scottish mountains for the Connaught Hills, arriving with the new English agents that leased land, and they were suited to the hard life. Others sold cabbage plants, or they would have been seed potatoes if it was a spring fair. Lone widows sat on crates with a couple of hens or ducks inside, often with their eggs for sale as well. Since Micheál had gone away, Tig hired a labourer for the day. It's 6 shillings from the sale money, but you're too young on your own, a store, he told Manus. The labourer enjoyed the day of reprieve from farm work and eagerly assisted. Each owner carefully herded his precious stock.